Coming up, Michael Portillo hops on a train to explore the Britain of his youth.
And our next guests have just hopped off a plane from the States to join us. Jake Gyllenhaal and Daniela Melchior will be chatting to us shortly about their new film, Roadhouse.
Yes, Daniela plays an ER doctor who's kept busy by Jake's character, Elwood Dalton, a former fighter who comes to the Florida Keys to work as a bouncer in a local dive bar. But she's not your average doctor and he's not your typical bouncer. Let's take a look.
So you like to fight? You ever win?
No one ever wins a fight.
A friend of mine suggested I come talk to you. I own a roadhouse out in the Florida Keys. Lately, it's been attracting the wrong clientele. I can pay you good money.
I should warn you, people have a certain way of getting things done around here.
Hey, fellas! Once Knox is on the job, it's over, baby.
Let's welcome Jake Gyllenhaal and Daniela Melchior to the show.
Welcome, guys. Come in. Shake hands.
Oh, God.
It's a whole extra element that we've introduced. Listen, thank you so much for coming to see us, guys. Great to have you here. So many people are excited about this movie, and lucky Anita and I got to see it early. So it is so much fun. Jake, I'm going to start with your character, Elwood Dalton. Tell us a bit about him.
Elwood Dalton, Elwood P. Dalton. He's an ex-UFC fighter who's sort of been running around the amateur fight circuit. And he gets, there's a bar owner who finds him on the amateur fight circuit and offers him a job at this roadhouse in the Florida Keys. And, you know, he's a bit lost. He doesn't really know what to do with his life. And he ends up over there and a lot of stuff happens. Yeah.
A lot of stuff happens.
Yeah.
And Ellie, he meets your character. So, Daniela, tell us about Ellie, your character. I loved her, a very refreshing leading lady.
Thank you. So, Ellie is a doctor. She lives in Florida Keys. She crosses paths with Dalton. And she's an unconventional love interest. I don't know, she's a badass. She needs therapy ASAP. She has daddy issues. And she will have a unconventional ending as well with Dalton, I would say.
She does. She's a really dynamic character. So this film is a reimagining of a 1989 movie. Patrick Swayze was in the original. Jake, did you feel pressure to do that justice, particularly as, you know, you knew him, you worked together?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't feel pressure. I felt responsibility. But, I mean, I come from the theater, and in the theater we play each other's roles. You know, there's classic roles you always play. So and also, so did Patrick. So to me, it didn't feel a responsibility, though. I have characters a lot of tattoos, and I do wear a tattoo in dedication to him because I kind of wanted to bring him along with me and bring the energy of the whole character along with me. I mean, he was one of a kind. He was the kindest. He was always so supportive at the beginning of my career. So,
what's your tattoo?
Oh, well, see, I was told I'm not allowed to say. You have to go watch the movie and freeze frame. That's like, you know what I mean? But it's in, there's one that's in dedication to him.
Wow. Oh, how beautiful. Yeah. That's a lovely thing to do. And what about the kind of physical sporting aspect of this? Because, you know, you play, as you mentioned, a mixed martial arts fighter. Now, we've seen you play a boxer in the film Southpaw. I wonder how the training compared and the sort of physicality of those different sports.
Yeah, well, I mean, I definitely used a lot of the skills that I learned when I was doing Southpaw. But this is different. Mixed martial arts is just a whole different form, you know? It's everything, really. And it was incredible to train for it. I mean, we were working with some of the best stunt people in the business, with Garrett Warren, who's our stunt coordinator, and Steve Brown, our fight coordinator. And we designed all of these new ways of throwing and contacting and punching. So you've never really seen what they've done before. And then also we had UFC fighters and ex-UFC fighters all over the film. So that was also special.
The fight choreography is exquisite on this. And Daniela, is it true that you'd all go and watch him on set?
Of course, because it's a one lifetime opportunity. And I remember also I had a few friends and from my team as well visiting me there. And of course, we stopped our lives to go watch this.
They built the road. They actually built the bar. So it was right by the ocean. And so it was a bar, though we were working. So there was no real, it wasn't a real bar, but we all hung out there because it was a great place to be.
Lauren and I decided that we could hang out there. I mean, it's, you say it's a dive bar, but it looks super nice to us.
And the music is great, you know.
And, like, yeah, it's live music.
Didn't you take some souvenirs from the set?
Yes, I brought like one coaster or two, but I was allowed to. Like they let me, of course.
Now, Jake wasn't the one having all the fun as well, because you've done some action films in the past. You've done Guardians of the Galaxy and Fast 10, and so you know how to drive. But you got to drive something else in this as well.
Boats, yeah.
How was that?
Challenging, yeah. I'm very afraid of waves and ocean, and but it went well. Yeah.
Look how cool you look.
Oh, you look totally relaxed there.
Yeah.
By the way, that boat is a lake boat. It's not an ocean boat.
An ocean boat.
So, you know, she didn't have any of the same kind of ruddering that she would have on a boat. So she was trying to do, she was like handed the hardest thing to do. And also docking the boat so many different times and shots so hard.
And I tried to play cool, yeah.
Now, Jake, you mentioned being on the stage, and in complete contrast, it's been announced that you are going to be back on Broadway in Othello opposite Denzel. I mean, tell us how exciting this is. I mean, I'm so excited.
I'm equally excited, and I am also profoundly challenged and a bit frightened. It's the right way to be. You know?
So why decide to do it?
I mean, when you're offered an opportunity like that, not just Denzel, who's extraordinary, but also Mr. Shakespeare as well, those sort of two goats, you know, how can you not, you know, and I think that challenge is anything that requires that kind of courage, I sort of try and jump into. If there's a bit of fear, I always kind of want to try it, and it's a new thing, and I can't wait. I really can't wait.
I mean, we hope you bring it to the UK at some point.
With Denzel.
Well, I think you need to talk to Denzel about that.
Well, listen, we keep our fingers crossed. For now, thank you so much. Roadhouse is going to be available to stream on Prime Video from the 21st of March. Joined now by someone else who's been on their travels recently, let's welcome Michael Portillo to the studio.
Welcome, Michael. Now, you've been racking up the miles on your latest series of Great British Railway Journeys. Back on our screens next week. Tell us what we're in a treat for.
Well, this next series is in the United Kingdom. It's in Scotland, in the southern counties and across the north of England. And as usual, it's not just about railways, it's about history as well. And the history we're looking at is the history of the post-war period, to which I can be a guide. I used to go around with a guidebook. But now, because we've reached the post-war period, which is the period through which I have lived, most of it anyway, I am the guide. And I tell you about developments in art, in architecture, in social policy, in social events, as we go around. I mean, things like the Catholic Cathedral of Liverpool, which is a post-war building, or the invention of Oxfam, which is a post-war phenomenon. Or about Philip Larkin, a post-war poet. So wherever we get off the train, we talk about what was going on in the post-war period.
Oh, well, I'm up for a bit of Larkin. Let's have a look at what you've got in store for us.
I'm heading out on a series of railway journeys to explore the Britain of my youth.
Down she goes.
I'm a boomer, born in the decade after the Second World War.
Sergeant?
I'll recall the optimism and excitement of rebuilding a nation exhausted by conflict.
Did you see a few sparks there?
Relive the agony and the ecstasy of British Rail.
This is a stallion of a train.
And marvel at the new society and cultures that emerged in post-war Britain.
It's better than I remembered.
I mean, also, you have the weather, which always helps. So, as you say, you go into these places that have a connection with post-war British history, including a furniture company that I think made chairs for the late Queen's coronation.
Yes, this is a furniture company in High Wycombe, I think, and that is famous for its furniture. And they're so proud because, indeed, they made all the chairs that sat in Westminster Abbey for the Queen's coronation. Gosh, we're talking about 70-something years ago, aren't we? And some of those chairs are still extant. And there was a letter, I think, from the Member of Parliament saying thank you very much because he sat on this chair for 8 hours and felt comfortable. I mean, the wonder is not about the chair. How did he sit there for 8 hours? How did he do that?
And as you just said, you visited Oxford's first ever charity shop, Britain's first ever charity shop.
Yes.
And we know you like your attire. Did you pick anything up? Nice blazer?
Oh, look, if they'd had anything colourful, I would, of course, have snapped it up. But colourful clothes are not all that common, are they? So I didn't find anything that day. But, of course, I will be supplying Oxfam shops in years to come.
Yes.
All this has to move on somewhere, doesn't it?
Now, obviously, you know, you are many series into this kind of love letter to train travel. And, Jake, I think you love a bit of train travel too, because you shared this lovely picture on your Instagram.
A picture of a window.
Yes. But it's the romance of the speeding countryside.
That's absolutely true. I do love a train. I particularly love a train window. And I love getting to places. So, you know, put all those things together and, you know, there it is. No, I really do. I do love train travel.
Jake was telling me that he uses trains a lot in France.
Yes.
Now, that is a serious country for trains. Yes. I mean, the trains are so excellent in France.
What about really Portugal? Are Portuguese trains, Daniela?
They're always late. It's true, though. But one thing I can say, we have this beautiful journey that they don't have all year, but you can Google, called the Presidential. That is a very old train, but well-preserved, where you can have wine tasting and, like, chef food tasting as well while you go next to Douro River. It's beautiful.
Wow. I've done that. Civilized.
Absolutely superb. And the Douro River is where the port comes from.
Sorry?
The Douro is where you get port.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, port wine. And you can have... then you have a stop and you can do the port wine tasting.
You see?
Michael, that's the next series, sorted.
Absolutely.
You can see great British Railway Journeys from Monday at 6:30 on BBC Two, and iPlayer and previous series are on there too. Oh, so exciting. So many wonderful messages coming in. Teresa says, Jake, you're a class act. I can't wait to see the new film.
It's a good one. And another one here from Stephen who says, I love watching your railway shows and can't wait to see the new series, Michael.
Mine or his?
Stephen.
Oh, yeah.
Daniela Robb says, loved you in Fast 10. Cannot wait to check out Roadhouse. So lots and lots of love coming in for all of you.
That's so nice. So lovely.
Thank you, guys.
Love from the UK. Enjoy the rest of your trip. Thank you so much.
Thank you to all
of our guests tonight. Jake, Daniela, Michael, and of course, our Nikki for this week's Watchdog.
Alex and Roman will be here tomorrow, and joining them will be actor Jason Watkins, Gabby Logan, and we'll be catching up with Radio 1's Molly King on her epic Red Nose Day challenge. Have a great evening. Goodbye.
See you later.